Okay, good afternoon guys. We'll start with the remaining portion for the food poisoning. So yesterday we have discussed about the some of the common causes or some of the common agent which cause the food poisoning. In that we have discussed about the viruses and bacteria, and we have understand how they will got transmitted and how it would be so severe or mild condition, or if they are fatal or anything. Okay, and we have understand the various species of that particular virus or bacteria and how they will lead to the any kind of infectious thing. Okay, and we have seen out that especially we have discussed all this rotavirus, hepatitis, adenovirus, salmonella and shigella. Okay, so we have understand, and the most common thing which we have identified in the most of the cause this causative agent, that almost each and everyone may lead to the one of the common thing which is known as dehydration. And it also shown that dehydration could consider as a severe things among the all these bacteria, so which can lead to the again difficulty in that person who has been contaminated with any of. And we have seen like some of the virus or some of the bacteria, they are more prone for the infants, child, old age people or any age group which having the immune compromise, okay, or they have suppressant in the immunity. Okay, so they are most targeting, and then the this virus and bacteria, again those who are healthy volunteer and they are immune well protected, so they are showing a symptomatic kind of thing and they will get recover. Okay, so today we'll discuss about this parasites and protozoa. Okay, so here we have example of parasites like Trichinella spiralis. Okay, so as you guys know, like this Trichinella spiralis is a viviparous nematode parasite. Okay, so it is a viviparous nematode parasite, and it especially occur in the rodents, pig, deer, hyenas and human, and it will be responsible for the disease which is called as trichinosis. Okay, so trichinosis nothing but it is also called as pork worm due to being typically encountered in the undercooked pork products. Okay, so it is also known as pork worm. Why? Because it will be cooked under undercooked pork product. Okay, so it should not be confused with the pork tapeworm. Okay, so pork tapeworm is the separate worm infection. Okay, here we are calling pork worm because they are mainly due to that undercooked product of that. Okay, so this is what this Trichinella spiralis. Okay, so it is the one of the smallest nematode parasites of human, and which is having the unusual life cycle. Okay, and are one of the most widespread and clinical importance parasite in the world. Okay, and this small adult worm mature in the small intestine of the definitive host. So definitive host nothing but the host which is responsible for the further spreading that particular disease, or you can say origin. Okay, origin of that particular infection. So here we have such an example like pig. Okay, so each adult female produce batches of live so it will be like larva system and all those things. So this is how it will be produced. Okay, and what could be the symptoms? Okay, when anyone got infected with this Trichinella spiralis, see, the first and most symptom will be mostly commonly appear between 12 hour and it will 48 hours of ingestion of any kind of infected meat product. Okay, so what will happen? See, the migration of the adult worms, okay, in the intestinal epithelium can cause traumatic damage to the host tissue. Okay, so they are going to target the intestinal epithelium and they are leading to the most traumatic stage. Okay, and their waste product, okay, whatever will be there, they excrete, can provoke an immunological reaction. So whatever the resulting inflammation will be there, they can cause some of the symptom like nausea, vomiting, sweating and diarrhea. Okay, and after 5 to 7 days, okay, the appearance of this system could changes to, and they may lead to the facial edema. A facial edema, nothing but swelling in the face, okay? And fever may occur. And after 10 days following the ingestion, intestine muscular pain will be there. There will be a difficulty in breathing, weakening of pulse and blood pressure, damage to the heart, and various nervous disorder may occur. Eventually, what will happen? It can lead to a fatal like condition. Why? Because you have we have seen that there is a fluctuation in the blood pressure, weakness of pulse rate, and heart damage. So due to the heart failure, it can also lead to the death, and sometimes it may lead to the respiratory complication or kidney malfunction. So all due to the larval migration. Okay, so whatever this Trichinella spiralis parasite, as you know, parasite, they will generate their further multiplication in the form of larva. Okay, like you can take as an example of mosquito and all those things. So replants, so they will go and formation of larva will be there. Like you have the one of the classic life cycle of that parasite, which will be responsible for like Plasmodium vivax and all those things for malaria. You might be, you have studied their life cycle. So how they may form zygotes and zygomates and all those things, and then further may lead to the like multiplication into the host, like human. Okay, so they may lead, so therefore exogenously you are giving the drugs like chloroquine, primaquine. Okay, so they may go and they will arrest the growth of the multiplication of that larva, and then they will control the fever, chills and all those things. Okay, so similarly here in this Trichinella spiralis also the same thing will be happen. Whenever the host, any human being who contaminated with these parasites due to the undercooked meat product, so they may initially, okay, 2 hours to 48 hours, they may develop some of the symptoms, like they can cause nausea, vomiting, diarrhea and all those things. Okay, but how it will be leading, because they are going to damage the intestinal epithelial cells, and it will be a traumatic stage. Okay, but after 5 to 7 days, this symptom may develop into the facial edema, okay, swelling, and then fever may appear. Okay, but after 10 days the symptom can be a dramatic, or it will be pose the severe threat to the host, like it may lead to the respiratory failure, malfunctioning of the kidney, weakening of the pulse rate, fluctuation in the blood pressure, so damaging to the heart, and the person can lead to the death due to the cardiac failure. Okay, so this is all symptom will be there. Okay, and this like how you can treat. Okay, so here we do not have that much importance of treatment, but okay, for general awareness you can know. See, sometimes what is the first thing they will do, they will do the biopsy of muscle, okay, which will be used for the trichinosis detection. Okay, so you know, like biopsy for most of the in most of the cases of the any organ failure, they will identify first of all like primary biochemical test. Okay, like if you have the bio, if suppose your liver failure is there, so how they will identify? First, there will be a elevation in the lipid profile test. Okay, liver function test. Okay, in like ALT, okay, SGOT, SGPT, ALP, all those things. And further, if they want to finalize that whether liver got full, like there will be a damage of sinusoid cell, okay, all these cells or whatever there, so they will take the they will perform the biopsy. So similarly here they will also take the muscles biopsy to identify that trichinosis detection. And so sometime what will happen, they will perform some of the immunodiagnostic tests, okay, which are available for that. Okay, so you know, most of the time this treatment with anti-worm drug like albendazole, mebendazole, okay, so it will be preferred for the any kind of worm infection. Okay, so in albendazole, most of the case like children, okay, those who are below 8 years and all those things, in that time albendazole and mebendazole, they are available in a single dosage form, like either in the syrup form or tablet form. They will give in the night, and they will look for the next day for the any kind of worm infection is there or not. So it will be excreted via the fecus. Okay, So this is what the best treatment also recommended for the trichinella spiralis, like drug like albendazole and mebendazole. Okay. So this symptom, whatever will be there, like sometime we have seen that pain will be there, like traumatic due to the intestinal epithelium. Sometimes swelling will be there. So for that, you can give also the some of the analgesic and steroid, like corticosteroid, like prednisolone and dexamethasone, like drug. Okay. So this is how you can control or you can treat or perform the treatment. So this is what about the trichinella spiralis. Okay. So next we have protozoan. Okay. In protozoan we have first example is Entamoeba histolytica. So I hope that you heard this one, Entamoeba histolytica, more common in the microbiology or some of the pharmacology where you are studying about the some of the antibiotic and all those things. So here, like it is commonly, it is in an anaerobic parasitic amoebozoan, okay, which is the part of genus Entamoeba. Okay, so this is what commonly it is infecting human and other primates, causing amoebiasis. Okay, so the disease which is going to be affecting via the Entamoeba histolytica, it is known as amoebiasis. Okay. So this histolytica is according to one of the epidemiology survey, like it is estimated to infect about 35 to 50 million people worldwide every year. Okay, so you can understand or you can think like how severe, like 35 to 50 million worldwide. Okay, this are going to infect, and that mortality rate, okay, due to the infection of Entamoeba histolytica, the mortality rate will be per year worldwide would be a 55,000 approximately. Okay, so this again, like it is a need of our, like there will be also it may, like earlier virus and bacteria which we have seen, only some of are like consider like which can lead to the fatal like condition, but here we have data, okay, for Entamoeba histolytica that it can lead to the mortality near about 55,000 people each year. Okay, so earlier what it was thought that 10% of the world population was infected, but this figure predate the recognition that at least 90% of this infection were due to the second species of this Entamoeba, this part. Okay, so there was a like again there will be a research and all those things in that they are identified that most of the cases what we have seen the epidemiology like 35 to 50 million, so in that only 10 to 15% are due to the Entamoeba histolytica, but again the same genome will be there like Entamoeba, but the species would be a Diaspora, which could be responsible for major infection of this. Okay, so some of the mammals like dog and cats can become infected transiently but are not thought to contribute significantly to transmission. So there will be from dog and cat you cannot consider like so much. So how it will be transmit? Okay, so the tropozoid, okay, which is at the active stage, exists only in the host and in fresh loose fecus. Okay, so it will be transmitted via the fecal route. Okay, so just commonly thing. Okay, and they will transmit it at the tropozoid stage, means it will enter at the active stage. Okay, and some of these are survive almost like outside in host in water, soil and food, especially under moist condition. Okay, so the infection whatever will be there, it can occur when person puts anything into their mouth that has touched the fecus of person who is infected with Entamoeba histolytica, and some person like swallow something such as water, food which is already contaminated with Entamoeba histolytica, or anything which is picked from the contaminated surface or figure. So you can think like if touching of the infected person fecus or anything like this person who already infected, if you are touching his object or okay, like water, anything, and if you are contaminating, so there will be increased risk that you may also got infected via that thing. Okay, and sometime what will happen, this cyst, okay, cyst are nothing but the eggs, okay, like tropozoid stage. Okay, So this ant amoeba histolytica seeds, which pick up from contaminated surface or finger, okay. So these seeds are readily killed by heat and by freezing temperature and survive for only a few months outside of the host. So if you having the proper storage or anything, so there will be a no generation of this further propagates, okay. When these seeds are swallowed, they cause infection by exciting, means nothing but releasing the prophozoite stage in the digestive tract, okay. And the pathogenic nature of this ant amoeba histolytica, okay, it will identify in the 1875, like it is too old, okay, this one. And the amoeba, okay, it can actually bore into the intestine. Bore means nothing, like they will go and they will can produce a hole over there, okay, so in the intestine wall. So what will happen if there is a bore? So it may lead to the lesion, means nothing but liquid generation of, or a liquid will flow down, okay. Lesion and intestinal symptom, and it may reach to the bloodstream, okay. From there it can reach to the different vital organ of the human body, especially the liver, but sometime it may also reach to the lungs, brain, spleen, etc. And a common outcome of the invasion of the tissue is a liver, okay, which can be a fatal if it's untreated, okay. And ingested red blood cells are sometimes are seen in the amoebic cell cytoplasm, okay. So you can consider like it is a one of the most causative agent or which can harm a person to the fatal like condition, okay. So what could be a risk factor for this ant amoeba histolytica? As we have seen, like it will be transmit via the fecal route, okay. So obviously there will be a poor sanitary condition which will increase the risk of contracting amoebiasis via the ant amoeba histolytica, okay. And one of the survey which has been done in the United States of America, that there is a much higher rate of amoebiasis related mortality in some of the parts like California and Texas, which might be caused by the proximity of those states to the ant amoeba histolytica endemic areas, okay, such as Mexico and other part of Latin America and Asia also, okay. And this ant amoeba histolytica is also recognized as an emerging sexually transmissible pathogen, which especially it will be also considered for in during this day, okay. Although it is unclear whether there is a causal link, okay, or studies indicate a higher chance of being infected with ant amoeba histolytica if one is also infected with HIV, okay. So there is a just studies are going on, okay. It is not still, it is unclear whether those people who are having the HIV, they are also risk for this ant amoeba histolytica infection, okay. So it will be again difference, okay. So what is the diagnosis thing, okay. So mainly diagnosis of ant amoeba histolytica sometime will be confirmed by the microscopic examination. For why their micro, because we have just studied that at the early stage or active stage it will be transmit in the form of propagules. So therefore at the early stage it will be confirmed, or sometime what will happen, suitably preserved fecal specimens will be there, or smear of aspirate or scraping obtained by the protoscopy and aspirate of abscesses or any kind of tissue specimen will be done, and their microscopic evaluation has been done, okay. And sometime blood test will be also recommended when healthcare provider believe that infection may have spread beyond the intestine to some other organ of the body such as the liver. In that condition they will go for the liver test, okay. And however, this blood test may not be helpful in the diagnosis current illness, because the test can be positive if the patient has had amoebiasis in the past, even if they are not infected at present, okay. So it will be also like, because what will happen, as we have you can correlate just commonly, okay, just correlate, like if someone had that carcinoma or any type of cancer, if the tumor has been removed via the any surgery procedure, but if single cell will also remain, so there will be a chance that again there will be a multiplication of that unwanted growth, unwanted cell. Okay, so similarly here, if the any person who had this infection in the past, but at present if that person has not infected, but the little amount of this trochocytes, if they are present into the body, so it may show the positive test and person may undergo for the test. Okay, so this test, first most diagnosis always required for confirmation that it's microscopic evaluation. After microscopic evaluation only you can go for the blood sampling if that infection may cross beyond the intestine, okay, and it is going to affect the other organ, vital organ like liver. Okay, that time you can go, and there will be again one more test will be there, like stool antigen detection and polymerase chain reaction, okay, which are available for the diagnosis. Okay, so these are the common diagnoses which are available for the entamoeba histolyte. Okay, so what could be the most common treatment for this? See, the most common treatment for this intestinal infection due to this entamoeba histolytica, some of the drugs like metronidazole. Okay, so metronidazole is also used as an antiworm or anti-infect drug, which can be used in the most of the worm infection or any kind of bacterial infection. This will be a preferable drug. Okay, so this kind of drug will be given. Okay, so this is what about you have that entamoeba histolytica. Okay, so next we have that one more protozoan is Xeradia lamblia. Okay, so it is also known as Xeradia intestinalis. Okay, one more name of this Xeradia lamblia. Okay, it is nothing but it is a flagellated parasitic microorganism which colonize and reproduce in the small intestine. So therefore the name has been given the Xeradia intestinalis. Okay, because they are the small flagellated parasitic microorganism which will colonize and reproduce, means nothing but they will go and multiply into the small intestine and they will cause a condition like diarrhea. Okay, because of this genus Xeradia, and this commonly the disease which will be occur due to Xeradia lamblia, which is known as Xeradiasis. Okay, and this does not spread via the bloodstream, nor does it spread to the other parts of GI tract. Okay, but remain confined to the lumen of the small intestine. Okay, so it will be, it's not like that, it will be transmit to the any other vital organ. Okay, but it will remain into the small intestine, and there are multiple transmission methods, include infected drinking water, which is the most common method of transmission for this parasite. Okay, so drinking of contaminated water. Okay, then Xeradia trophozoites absorb their nutrients from the lumen of the small intestine and they are anaerobic. Okay, so you know that meaning of aerobic and anaerobic. So this is one of the type of anaerobic. Okay, if this organism is split and stand, it is characterized pattern resembler to the familiar like smiley face symbol. Okay, so sometimes this may produce this kind of infection. Okay, so for this like it is a just common thing like this Xeradia one, also known as Xeradia intestinalis, because they will remain and they will colonize and multiply in the small intestine only. Okay, and they are not going to pass this infection to the any other body part or either like any kind of bloodstream. Okay, only it will be remain in the lumen of the small intestine, and the disease produced by this Xeradia like diarrhea, which is known as Xeradiasis. Okay, and they are the most common infected via the drinking of contaminated water. Okay, so this is what about you have about this Giardia lamellia. So I hope that you have understood about the each viruses like rotavirus, hepatoadenovirus, bacteria like Salmonella, Shigella, Vibrio cholera, E. coli, parasite like Trichinella spiralis, okay, protozoan entamoeba, histolytica and Giardia lamellia. Okay, so we have understand the what is the why we have understand so deeply because the causative agent. So sometime in the exam they will ask in the 5-mark question like explain the role of, just giving example that explain the role of rotavirus in case of food poisoning. So you have to know what is the rotavirus, what are the subfamily, and what is the transmission via the for this bacteria, and what could be the symptoms. Okay, so if you know that much about the each causative agent, it will be much benefit for you also. Okay, so we have also seen that about Salmonella. So we have seen that most common condition like diarrhea and all the thing, but again there will be a something was mentioning that it may lead to the typhoid like condition also due to the Salmonella typhi. Okay, so this is how you, and this is what we have seen just now about the Trichinella spiralis. Okay, so this is mostly commonly due to the eating of undercooked pork preparation food. Okay, so this is also known as pork worm. Okay, so this is what we have seen, and rotavirus is also known as stomach flu, but it is not like influenza virus. Okay, because they are producing the some of the severe conditions. So therefore we have understand all this in a detail. Okay, now we'll move on the next slide. See, what is causing food poisoning? See, most commonly you we have seen the causative agent. Apart from that causative agent, some of the time chemicals like pesticide, heavy metal and gasoline. So how the role of this pesticide and all those things will be there? See, as you know, like during the farming, to safeguard your farm, like fruits, vegetable and all those things during growing, so you will spray some pesticide, insecticide, or and sometime you will for preservation of food you will apply some of the pesticide or any kind of thing. So they may lead to this kind of poisoning thing because some people can tolerate and some cannot tolerate, and heavy metal and all those things. So due to, because for the like heavy metal, I have give you the one of the example for lead in the Maggi preparations. Okay, because they will enhance the taste, and for the preparation for the longer period they can stay without any harmful. So this is what sometime it may lead to the food poisoning. And you know, we have studied about the mushroom in the last chapter, like how serious this mushroom poisoning can be, the can be there. Okay, and Datura also we have seen. Okay, and some of them like puffer fish, ciguatera. So this is what one of the seafood which can be also lead to the food poisoning. Okay, so almost all are due to the sometime what will happen, we have seen, like there will be a poor sanitization and sometime preparation and cooking of food. Okay, so we have seen, like if you are not storing food properly, if you are not freezing food properly, if you are not like suppose if you take example of milk, okay, if you are not boiling properly it, like common technology like pasteurization, okay, if you are not boiling at 80 degrees centigrade, so there will be chance that there will be some bacteria will be there in the milk which can lead to the some of the infection in the respiration. Okay, so this is how it may lead to the, so proper preparation required for each and every type of food. Okay, and sometimes packaging and storage. Okay, so as we have seen, like poor packaging and storage, like we have discussed about, like if there is a breakdown of the any of food seeds or anything while packaging or storage, so it may again lead to the development or contamination of the food. Okay, then fecal, one of the most common transmission for any kind of bacteria, viruses and all those things, and oral route, person to person, and use of inanimate articles. Okay, so by touching of any object and all those things which are lead for the food poisoning. So what is the common symptom of food poisoning? So like commonly will be, you can see in red mark, diarrhea will be there. Okay, diarrhea could be so severe that it will having the blood in the that fecus. Okay, so this could be one of the major symptom, and followed by the abdominal cramps will be there, fever, chills, headache, nausea and vomiting. Okay, and if there is all those things will be there, obviously person may lead to the weakness. Okay, if dehydration is there, because what will happen, continuous diarrhea, so it may again lead to the continuous sweating, salivation. Okay, and sometime what will happen, your mouth will become dry. Okay, weakness in the muscles. Okay, and difficulty in the swallowing, and sometime muscle paralysis will be also there. Okay, so these are the common symptom of food poisoning. Okay, so what is the treatment for food poisoning, symptomatic or pharmacological, anyone? Okay, so most common treatment, like which I always telling, like ORS, okay, oral rehydration, which you, if you are not having at home also, if you are not having ready made preparation at home, you can prepare at home also, like adding sugar, salt, water. Okay, so this is what your ORS. okay, and sometime if the person require emergency, so saline solution, which will be available in the different concentration, 5%, 8%, which will be given via the intravenous route for a slow IV bolus for a longer period. Okay, and sometime you can give antibiotic, but in most commonly it will be not preferred, because most of the time virus, bacteria of any species which can got resistant to this thing. Okay, and sometime what will happen, person already lose their weakness, because sometimes this antibiotic may also lead to the diarrhea kind of condition, so again the condition become worse. Okay, and sometime you can give an antitoxin to neutralize the toxin from C. botulinum. Okay, so which will be only preferred, should be given within 72 hours. Okay, and some drug like amitriptyline to control the numbness and tingling from cigarette poisoning. Okay, which is nothing but one of the marine creature. Okay, and apomorphine or ipecac syrup to cause vomiting and help rid the body of toxin. So which we have seen, like it is a common intensive supportive therapy. Okay, so which will help, like in case of mushroom poisoning and datura poisoning, all this poisoning, it will require taking out of the drug or toxin from the body. Okay, then you have atropine for mushroom poisoning. So as we have seen, why atropine, sometime what will happen, it may lead to the some of the condition like anaphylaxis and all those things, so that time it will be require atropine. Okay, then you have diphenhydramine, like antihistaminergic drug, and cimetidine for fish poisoning, so it may not lead to the further allergic like condition. So these are the some of the pharmacological treatment, like ORS, most commonly oral rehydration therapy, then if required severe, then you can go via intravenous saline solution, antitoxin, amitriptyline, apomorphine and ipecac to rid out the toxin from the body, atropine for mushroom poisoning, and diphenhydramine and cimetidine for fish poisoning. Okay, so this, and some of the most common also is there, like mannitol for nerve related symptom for because of ciguatera poisoning, and anti-secretory agent, because we have seen in the few slides that there is a more sweating will be there, salivation will be there, to reduce that it will be required, and diphenoxylate with atropine. So this can be tapered, dose is tapered to improve the condition from the diarrhea. And loperamide, it is the one of the most common drug, okay, and it is the best drug to control the diarrhea. Okay, and it will be also held down in the retention of electrolyte into your body. Okay, so whenever you like this, I will also tell personally, because this loperamide, it is a very cheapest drug and having the best outcome from this diarrhea like condition. Okay, so this is what you have the treatment. So we have studied about the food poisoning, what is the food poisoning, types of food poisoning, causes of food poisoning, symptom of food poisoning, and pharmacological and symptomatic treatment of food poisoning. Okay, so I hope that you have understand about the food poisoning and how severe it will be, what we usually think. Okay, so this is what we have understand, and we'll stop here and we'll start the new chapter इन द नेक्स्ट क्लास. ओके, चलो टेक केयर.
थैंक यू सर.
हाँ,
थैंक यू सर.
ओके ओके.